Hey, good morning, church. Whoop, whoop. Good to see everybody here today. We are a team this morning, so we're going to be throwing some stuff out there, and hopefully we'll get on the spot, and we're going to do some color commentary. That'll be Janet's role. She'll do the color commentary, and I'm going to get some information, and we're going to get this thing done. What's the color commentary? Yeah. Okay, well, let's backdrop. Like, when you're watching a football game, there's a main announcer who gives all the, you know, it's third down, blah, 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 blah. And then there's the one who's the color analyst, the color commentary. They give the really good stuff, okay? That's where, you know, they talk about, oh, I was talking to Joe Blow, the quarterback, before the game, and he said X, Y, and Z. So you have the really good stuff is what I'm saying, okay? All right, very good. Hey, well, I just want to give a greeting just in the last few weeks, actually. In August, I threw down the gauntlet and got through to Canada. Woohoo! I got back after a year and a half to Canada, and we had a leaders retreat. Just had a really good time with the Dove leaders in Canada, and it's possible now to get across the border and get back. I know that for a fact. to Canada, we're up in Ontario, and just had a really good time. And it literally was a year and a half since I've been there, and I mean, we've had a gazillion Zoom calls and what have you, you know, but you know, it was just amazing how hungry people were to be back together and just to be together, and so we're just excited. Greetings from Dove Canada and our leaders there, and also just good things happening around the world. We're also involved in India and Dove India, and we are doing a Zoom conference, an all-Zoom conference in three languages coming up at the end of October. So anyway, Nate, maybe I will call on you again to help us with technology. But we're going to do English and Hindi and Telugu, all right? So you don't have to translate, Nate. You're off the hook for that. So we'll have translators there, but it's all about Zoom Translate. And so we're excited about what God is doing in India. They're taking full advantage of what's happening in the pandemic and preaching the gospel, and the churches are growing, and it is a difficult time, but also an exciting time, and so forth. So, are we ready?
We're ready.
Okay. It's time now for story time with Brian and Janet. All right. So, Rosetto Vallifor is a town that lies 100 miles southeast of Rome in Italy. Oh, okay, yeah, just before you go. There's an app. The notes that we have are on the church app. And so if you have the opportunity to download the church app, I'm very proud of this. I actually got my notes in time to actually make the church app, okay? So it's a big accomplishment in my world, and so I'm really growing. So if you can, pull up the church app, you'll actually see a picture of our life group there, and you'll see some notes and stuff that we're going to be talking about. And having said that, let's start the story over again. Brian says, Rosetta Vallifor is a town that lies 100 miles southeast of Rome in Italy.
For centuries, the people of Rosetta worked in the marble quarries in the surrounding hills or cultivated the fields in the terraced valley below, walking 4 and 5 miles down the mountain in the morning and then making the long journey back up the hill at night. It was a hard life. The townsfolks were barely literate and desperately poor without much hope for economic betterment until word reached Rosetta at the end of the 19th century of the land of opportunity across the ocean.
In January of 1882, a group of 11, 10 men and one boy, set sail for New York City. They ventured west from the city, ending up finding jobs in the slate quarries 90 miles to the west in a small town of Bangor, Pennsylvania, just north of Allentown. Soon, one group after another packed up their bags and headed for Pennsylvania until the initial stream of immigrants became a flood. In 1894 alone, some 1,200 people applied for passports to America, leaving entire streets of their old village in Italy abandoned and quiet.
They began buying up land on the rocky hillside, connected to Bangor only by a steep, rutted wagon path. They called it Rosetto. If you wandered up and down the streets of Rosetto in Pennsylvania in the first few decades after 1900, you would have heard only Italian spoken. Rosetto, Pennsylvania was its own tiny, self-sufficient world, all but unknown by the society around it, and may well have remained that way, but for a man named Stuart Wolfe.
Wolfe was a physician from Oklahoma. He spent his summers at a farm he bought in Pennsylvania. His house was not far from Rosetto. One summer, Wolfe was invited to give a talk at a local medical society. After the talk was over, one of the local doctors invited Wolfe to have a drink. He said, "You know, I have been practicing for 17 years. I get patients from all over and rarely find anyone from Rosetta with heart disease."
At the time, heart attacks were an epidemic in the United States. They were the leading cause of death in men under the age of 65. It was impossible to be a doctor and not see heart disease. But Wolfe was also a man of deep curiosity. If somebody said there was no heart attacks in Rosetta, he wanted to find out whether that was true.
Wolfe approached the mayor of Rosetto and told him that his town represented a medical mystery. He enlisted the support of some of his students and colleagues. They pored over death certificates from the city, from the residents of the town, going back as many years as they could. They analyzed physician records. They took medical histories and constructed family genealogies. They constructed little booths where they could take blood and do EKGs. They invited the entire population of Rosetta to be tested.
The results were astounding. In Rosetta, virtually no one under 55 died of heart attack or showed any sign of heart disease. For men over 65, the death rate from heart disease in Rosetta was roughly half that of the United States as a whole. The death rate from all causes in Rosetta, in fact, was something like 30 or 35% lower than it should have been.
They went house to house and talked to every person age 21 and over. There was no suicide, no alcoholism, no drug addiction, and very little crime. They didn't have anyone on welfare. These people were dying of old age and only that alone.
The first thought was that the people must have held on some dietary practices from Italy that left them healthier than other Americans. But they quickly realized that wasn't true. They were cooking with lard instead of the much healthier olive oil they used back in Italy. Pizza in Italy was a thin crust with salt, oil, and perhaps some tomatoes, anchovies, or onions. Pizza in Pennsylvania was bread dough plus sausage, pepperoni, salami, ham, sometimes eggs. Sweets that were used to be reserved for Christmas and Easter now were eaten all year round. When Wolfe had dietitians analyze their typical eating habits, he found that a whopping 41% of their calories came from fat. They also smoked heavily, and many were struggling with obesity.
If it wasn't diet and exercise, then what about genetics? The people were from a close-knit group in the same region of Italy. Wolfe's next idea was that maybe they were a particularly hardy breed that protected them from disease. So he tracked down their relatives who were living in other parts of the United States to see if they shared the same remarkable good health as their cousins in Pennsylvania. Bad news, they did not.
He then looked at the region where they lived. Was it possible that there was something about living in the foothills of eastern Pennsylvania that was good for their health? The two closest towns to Rosetto were Bangor, which was just down the hill, and Nazareth, a few miles away. These were both about the same size as Rosetto and populated with the same kind of hardworking European immigrants. Wolfe combed through both towns' medical records. For men over 65, the death rates from heart disease in Nazareth and Bangor were something like three times that of Rosetta, another dead end.
What Wolfe slowly realized was the secret of Rosetta was not diet, was not exercise, was not genes, or was not the region where they were located. It had to be something else. As Wolfe walked around the town, he began to realize what it was. He saw how the people visited each other, stopping to chat with each other in Italian on the street or cooking for each other in their backyards. He learned about extended family clans that underlay the town's social structure. He saw how many homes had three generations living under one roof, how much respected grandparents were. He went to the mass at Mount Carmel Church and saw the unifying and calming effect of the church.
They had created a powerful protective community capable of insulating them from the pressures of the modern world. They were healthy because of where they were from and because of the community they had created for themselves. Wolf talked about the mysterious and magical benefits of people stopping to talk to each other on the street and having three generations living under one roof. The answer was to understand their culture, their sense of community.
In conclusion, Wolf discovered that the people of Rosetta did not eat healthily or exercise. Despite this, they still had no heart disease. Wolf concluded that their lack of heart disease was caused by the closeness of their families and their network of relationships. They didn't just buy bread. They stopped and talked to the baker and interacted there. They were close to their neighbors. They knew each other very well and were there for each other. This close-knit and expansive support group was Wolf's only explanation for the lack of heart disease.
You have to appreciate the idea of community, the values of the world we inhabit and the people we surround ourselves with have a profound effect on who we are. We want to understand the value of community.
Amen. This example was coined in Malcolm Gladwell's book, Outlier. And so we just wanted to bring that story here today so that, because we're focusing on our church community. And So Janet's going to come back up here in a little bit later and give some color commentary, as we mentioned. Somehow I get the feeling that if someone would have went missing in Rosetta, PA, then all the bakeries would have shut down, the mines would have shut down, and they all would have went looking for that person who was missing. So good job, Newport Church. We have something special here. We have a community here. We have something, a group of people that are working together, living out life together, and that's really what we want to build on. Psalm 68:6 talks about this. God sets the lonely in hearts. God places the lonely in families. He sets the prisoners free and gives them joy. So there's something about community. There's something about being a part of that that is a place where God wants to put people. He wants to place people. He wants to connect them relationally. And so many times when you're talking with people that are struggling, you know, the enemy's plan is always to isolate and divide. God wants to bring people together and so that they can be encouraged and build up in community. And I like to say, just as we're going forward, it takes community to reach a community. So we as a church, if we're going to reach our community, we have to have something here. There has to be something of value here that we can bring people in on. And that's the original in the Old Testament. The nation of Israel was supposed to be, life was supposed to be so good there, you can literally read this in Deuteronomy, that the other nations were going to be jealous. Like, hey, how do we get in on that thing? Is there an entrance fee? Is there an online application? Well, how do you get in on that thing, right? And so that is the richness of that community is part of what God wants to just continue to build and expand in our midst today. And because I believe that Christianity is meant to be lived out in community. So I think there's special grace if you're alone in a prison cell in some faraway place in a nation and, you know, maybe some of our brothers and sisters in Afghanistan are right now. But I think there's a special place if you have to be alone for a mission or for persecution or so forth. But the general pattern that God has for his church is that Christianity is meant to be lived out and worked out in community, you know, shifting, learning from each other, being encouraged by each other. When one person's down, the other person's up, and you're helping them. And we have that sense of growing and moving forward. So we're looking for God to spark a desire for relationship and a desire for connection in our midst. We want to continue to build upon that. So this summer, we've been studying the book of Acts, and I'm going to just give a little bit of a contrast between Acts chapter 2 and Acts chapter 17, which, where are we at in the book of Acts? Are we done? This is like a, we're in 18, okay, so, all right, good, we're right on, read a little bit of a review here then, so it's interesting, when we see Peter in Acts chapter 2, he's preaching a sermon, to the Jews in Jerusalem. So I have your notes here, Acts chapter 2, verse 14, if you want to click over there or flip over there. We're not going to read the whole thing, but I just want to give you a general sense of what's happening here. Peter stood up, verse 14, Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews, all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk as you suppose. So there was something happening there that people wanted to get in on. They thought they're drunk. Like there was something there. There was joy in the house. And it's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. And then he goes on, in the last days, God said, I'll pour out my spirit. And he actually quotes the prophet Joel there. And they talk about the sun and darkness and the moon. And verse 22, fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God for miracles, signs, and wonders. And he's talking now about Jesus, the Messiah, because the Jews were expecting a Messiah. And then he goes back into the Old Testament again. Oh, and David, so he's looking back at their worldview, because they all knew about Joel. They read that all of their lives. They all knew about David. And he's quoting David, talking about the Messiah here. And so literally he's speaking to them in Acts chapter 2, a message according to their worldview, right up until verse 36. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. So, he had a Jewish audience. So, Peter, in Acts chapter 2, he had a Jewish audience. So, the Jewish audience, they knew the scriptures, that because he twice referenced that, Joel and David. He twice referenced their worldview, and they believed in God. And they understood that they had sinned. So they knew that man had fallen away from God and that they had sinned. And it somehow that had to be atoned for. They had to be saved from that sin. So that was even the reason they were in Jerusalem. So God's there. We're separated from God. And so now we're going to kill a bunch of animals, cook them up, give part of it to the priest. And that was all part of their worldview. They knew they needed to have something to save them from their sins. And so that was all clear. Now I'm going to contrast that with what we find over in Acts 17. And we're just going to, you know, really, Acts 17, we have Paul preaching to the Greeks at Mars Hill. Now the best way to remember Paul preaching to the Greeks at Mars Hill is, it's like he was on Mars, okay? That's the best way to remember it. And that's really a little picture of what we are like as a community in the world where we are living, which is not like the Acts chapter 2 I'm proposing to us today. The world that we are living in 2021 is much more like Acts 17. It's a world that does not believe in God. So if I say, you know, God is this, God loves you, and the question would be, oh, which God? All right? That's a little bit more. We're going to read a little bit here in Acts chapter 17. And so on Mars Hill, Paul was feeling, you know, first of all, he goes and he starts to explain the gospel. And they kind of said, like, what God? And we'll just read it here a little bit. And so there's two groups of people in here. The Epicureans, which would be equivalent to our atheist today. And the Stoics, who were also, would be pretty much equivalent to pantheists. A pantheist would believe that there's many gods. Like Hindus are, they believe in many gods. So, when you're in India, on this professional person, a lawyer or a doctor, will stop on the way home from their practice, and they will give a sacrifice and bow down to a little idol on the way home from work, and then go home and have dinner with their family. That's pantheism, and there's many, many, many idols. Actually, they say millions of idols in India, but that's not only in India anymore. It's permeated our Western culture, and especially I would say this in the U.S. and Canada and Europe, that's really more what we have than Acts chapter 2. They believed in God, they knew what sin was, and they needed a Savior. Like that was the Jewish world, which was maybe like what we had in the United States, where we live. Maybe 60 years ago or 70 years ago, that would have been, hey, we preached the gospel and 3,000 people got saved. They all had the backdrop. But that now what happens here in Acts 17, Well, I'll just start reading in verse 16. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews, probably did that a different way, and God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace, day by day, those who happened to be there. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers, so there they are, the atheists and the pantheists, began to debate him. Some were asking, what is this babbler trying to say? Others remarked, he seems to be advocating foreign gods. They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. So they were talking about which god? Foreign gods. So that was their worldview that they were in there today. So verse 18 actually talks about, Paul kind of started off with the Acts 2 approach, and they're like, they're not getting this at all. So as we read through these verses here, we find that Paul transitioned from that approach, and he went back and he had to teach them who God was. He had to teach them, and this is, I'll just go through it. We won't read through the whole thing. But verse 19, then they took him and brought him to the meeting of the Areopagus, where they said to him, may we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting. You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we would like to know what they mean. All the Athenians and foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Does that sound like our culture? Does that sound like social media? Or is that just me? That looks like Facebook and Instagram there, and TikTok. There it is right there. Constantly listening to the latest idea, the latest opinion on whatnot. So I'm presenting that our culture in 2021 is much more like Acts 17 than it was in Acts chapter 2, where there was a knowledge of God and the need for forgiveness and so forth. So I don't need to read through here. You can read this all. Paul then stood up the meeting. Okay, I'll read a little bit. And said, people of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects, he goes on, talks about, I'll just read, so we don't lose speed here. Look carefully at your objects of worship. I even found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship, and this is what I'm going to proclaim to you. The God who made the whole world and everything is it in the Lord of heaven and does not live in temples built by human hands. So he starts off in that culture describing God, because they were pantheists. Or they were atheists. So he starts off describing the nature of God. Then he goes on and talks, he's not built by human hand. He gives life to everybody. He created all the people, all the boundaries of their lands. And he goes on and talks about, so he had to go through and establish who God was, what sin was, why there was sin in the world, and why there needed to be an answer for that sin. Because the Greeks in Athens, they were not offering sacrifices. They had no idea. They weren't killing animals and barbecuing them for their sins, because they did not have that paradigm. They had no idea what sin was, so Paul had to go through and do that. So we find here, I have a list in the app, that the Athenians, the Greeks, had no concept of God as a creator, no history of God as a creator, and no history of the fall of man and sin, and no sacrifice for sin. So that's the backdrop in Acts chapter 17. So as we are focusing on inviting people into this community and creating community in our homes and our places of work and coffee shops to bring them in, that's going to be our backdrop, because as I mentioned, it takes community to reach a community. It takes community, which we have to build and expressions of that, to reach community. So even the definition of God. So atheists today, their number one question that you would see online or see written in books and so forth is, how can you believe in a loving God when there is so much death and suffering in the world? Okay? That is like if the most recurring theme that you would see of what is written by atheists. But it's because they don't understand the nature of God and the nature of sin. They don't have any idea what sin is. They don't know that it's because of sin entering the world that that's why all the death and destruction that we see is happening and has happened. And it's a matter of man's sin. It's a result of man's sin, not the product of God's cruelty. They don't know God as a creator, and they have no sense of right and wrong. So the Jews in Acts chapter 2 might have said, yes, we need, we know the Jewish God, but the Greeks would say, which God? And, you know, and so it's interesting. I like to think, like in the last 10 years, this question that atheists are bringing up, in the last 10 years, all the music that is coming out of Bethel is a prophetic message to this, that God is good and his character will not be maligned. So church, that's something that we need to stand for, that we can be convinced that God is good, he's a father, he's got our best interest at heart, and that he is working even when we don't see that he's working. I hear those lyrics in my head, okay? All that music that's coming out is actually a prophetic response for the church, for our culture that we're living in here today. So, as I mentioned, Paul, he defined God as a creator, and he talked about this. Now, if we read the end there, towards the end there, so what happened when Paul preached his sermon on Mars Hill? There it is, verse 34. 32, let's start in 32. When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered. Okay, so mocking was one response. Others said, we want to hear you again on this subject. So some responded by saying, I want to hear more. And then there was some that became followers of Paul and believed and became believers. So it might sound really good. Hey, we got 3,000 saved in Acts chapter 2. We had an altar call and 3,000 were saved, you know, and now we got, you know, mocking. A few people want to hear more and some other people, you know, became Christians, like a few. But if you think about the audience, it's like talking to a room full of atheists and we got 2/3 of the people interested and on board. Like, that's a pretty big win. And so that's the environment that we are approaching. That's the environment that is going to be helpful for us. And so even as we, you know, to kind of think, you know, my main point for even going through that was we have to have community ourselves before we can export that community to reach our communities, our Mannheims, our Lidditz, our Lancaster, whatever our community is. It could be our workplace. And so we have to have some of this stuff in place so that we can, we have to have something to offer so that we can bring the community forth. Now, so at Newport Church, our vision is that everyone would know that they are a priest, okay? That means you don't have to go to the pastor, even in Rosetta. Those people had great community, amazing community, but they were still told they had to go to the priest. They couldn't go directly to God. So part of what we understand, and we would teach according to Scripture, been taught here many times, is that you know God yourself. You hear God from here. You hear from God yourself. Of course, you bring that into communion with the Scriptures. It gives you a framework to hear God. And so that you are a priest in yourself, but on top of that, a lot of people get that, especially since, you know, the last 400 years, a lot of Christians get that, but not every Christian gets that in addition to be a priest, they're also a minister, okay? So that's a bit of a newer thing that hasn't been heard as much. So in Acts chapter 4, verses 18 and 19, Jesus was at the temple there, and they brought out the scroll, and he's actually reading the scroll. He's reading the story from Isaiah, and he says this. He goes, and he's reading this, and he says, this day this scripture is fulfilled. When he literally read about himself, and he said, I'll just take it right from it. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me. He's quoting Isaiah, and he goes to preach the good news, to bring the year of the Lord's favor, to set the captives free. So now Jesus, something that was in the books for thousands of years, now Jesus is saying, this is true about me. Well, when he did that, he created a domino effect. Something shifted in the heavens that day, because now what all of creation was waiting for flipped. But not only did Jesus say that about himself, but he said that about his followers. Jesus said, I am anointed for these reasons. So as we join with him, then he went on and he trained the 12, his disciples, his apostles, and he sent them out. Then he trained the 72. And then, you know, the day of Pentecost came in Acts chapter 2, and then where it was 3,000. So as Jesus said, I am anointed, the word Christian actually means the anointed, the anointeds. So Jesus, not to get too deep here on a point of theology, but Jesus is the Christ. It's not his last name. It's not like Jesus Christ swear word. No, it's Jesus, the Christ, the anointed one. So when Jesus said that about himself, then Shane Good can say, I am anointed because I am a Christian. I am the anointed one. I am one of the anointed ones. So it was actually Antioch was the first place they were called Christians. Up and before that, it was called the Way. Okay, but then they became Christians, the Christ-like ones, were actually the anointed one. And then so then there was the 3,000 that were sent. And then there was the Newporters who were sent. And then there was the Westgadians who were sent. And then the Worship Centerians that were sent. And then the Life Churchers that were sent. And so that sending, it created a domino effect that each person being sent can say, I am anointed just like Jesus was anointed. Bam! Let that fall into your spirit. Tell your neighbor, I am anointed. Tell another neighbor. If you're watching at home, tell your dog, I am anointed. Tell your cat. Tell the TV. Tell me on the TV, I am anointed. And so we have the priesthood of the believers, but we also have the ministry of the believers. In Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 and 12, it says this, that he gave some as apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry. So we in the church, we have leaders and we have ministers. It's like two seats on the bus. Okay, and so we believe at Newport Church that we want to see everyone released in ministry, and that might be your workplace, it might be your neighborhood, but it also an aspect that we want to see is in this community developing thing called life groups, where we're knitted together in relationships, moving forward, helping each other. And so we've said here recently that Newport should be an apostolic center. And so an apostolic center has a training track. The two go together, apostle training. Wherever you see apostles, you see schools and training. And that's why I dove Global Leadership School. That's what I do. We're an apostolic movement. Larry's the leader, or quote, head apostle. I'm sure he wouldn't like me saying that. But anyway, he doesn't like titles a lot. But there's a training track. So wherever you see apostles, you see training. Well, life groups is actually one of our best tools to train. It's like a greenhouse where we can grow and train leaders. So we just want to paint this out. It's a place where you can minister and you can use your gifts and your anointing. And so that's, we have to have that why in our midst. Like, why do we have life groups at Newport? There's three reasons here. Number one, in your notes, to experience community, which I already painted that picture well. To experience community, but guess what? Communities had leaders. Have leaders. Life groups need leaders. And I'll get to more of that in a bit. To grow spiritually, we all want this. Now, a bunch of us were yesterday on the golf course, and there was two kinds of trees on that golf course. Those that were growing and those that were dying. And there was a lot of dying. If we played that golf course up at Fairview for the last 3 or 4 years, there's a bunch of trees that are dying. I mean, like there's stacks of big trees laying off to the side because they're dying. I don't know if it's the blight or whatever it was, but there's like these trees are falling and there's, you know, next, where's my ball? It's over by the dead tree, okay, you know. Anyway, what's good news, if you can't hit the ball straight, which applies to maybe some of us, then less trees is good because you don't get hit trees and you don't get behind trees, you know, and so forth. And we just had a great time. Who was out there yesterday playing golf? We had a great time seeing, Nolan and Derek crushing the ball. It was amazing out there. Had lots of good food and some really good shots, I would say, as well. In any case, to grow spiritually. If we're not growing, then we're starting to dry up. I'll not say die. I'll just say dry up because those trees were looking pretty bad. And to evangelize. So the third thing, that reason we want to have life group is to evangelize because we're living in Mars, a culture much like the one on Mars Hill, is the one that we're living in. And so that's why we have to have that place where people can come, because they might not come here. They might, you know, maybe it's easier to come into a place. So into a place, a home, a coffee shop for that first step into the kingdom. So life groups is embedded in the thread of who Newport is. We're not looking at it as a side option or a maybe, or it's not a la carte. Well, I'll have, you know, the steak, but not the potato. No, you can't. You know, life groups is integral to who we are, and it's a basic part of what we want to do here. And so I think at that point, I'm going to call for color commentary, the lovely Janet Sauder, to pick things up here.
I must say, I've never been given the color commentary role. It's kind of fun.
Yeah.
Okay. That's great, Brian. I love the whole analogy there between Acts 2 and Acts 17. And this is kind of one of my verses that I, John 10:10. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. And this is one that I hear so often, is like God kind of gets blamed for the first part. You know, and it's like he's getting blamed for something that's not his character. It's not who he is. He has come to come and give us life and to give it abundantly. So I would even challenge as Christians to know the character of God. You know, it's like he's given us a free choice. Yes, just because we experience bad things doesn't change who God is. You know, that's not how I determine who God is, because I've had to walk through a challenge or a struggle or something like that. Know who God is and kind of set that as a standard. And so when people were saying, you know, like, I don't know why God's doing this, you know, like, or how much can I handle? It's like, challenge them, like, who God is. And just kind of going back to John 10:10. Life groups.
Amen.
What a exciting opportunity. What can... I think back on our history of life groups, and I'm like, it's so powerful to have a group of believers with you, you know, that we have done life with. You don't have to be perfect. That's the whole thing. Life is not perfect, so you don't have to be perfect. Well, you know, they've been people there when you want to laugh and you rejoice with you. When, you know, someone's got a new job and you've all prayed for it and someone's got a job, you can rejoice. You can cry together. And it's powerful. You know, the Bible says that one will send 1,000 to flight and 2 10,000. Well, if you have a group of 6 or 10 people, you know, it's pretty powerful. There's, in football, the strategy. What is the strategy in football that's illegal because it's too effective and dangerous?
On the kickoff.
Anybody know? Someone's got to know.
It was outlawed many years ago.
It was outlawed because it was so powerful. It kind of, it's called the flying wedge or the flying V, mm-hmm. because it is too powerful and it literally runs over people and people get hurt. And, you know, that's a little bit way the agreement of your small group is, it's powerful. Mm-hmm. So I was kind of thinking here. 2 Timothy 2:2, you have heard me teach things that have been confirmed by many reliable witnesses. Now teach these truths to trustworthy people who will be able to pass them along to others. So what have I learned from others in small group? And I had to think back, okay, what were some of the things? And I kind of start thinking yourself, because the Bible also says, I passed on to you what was important and what has been passed on to me. So basically, what I received, I want to pass on to somebody else. And most important is Christ died for our sins. But I was thinking, what have I learned in life group over the years? And one of the things I learned is the joy of giving together. You know, like I can give, Brian and I can give together, but we can also give as a small group. You know, our group has rallied already in giving, like blessing a family for Christmas, or our group more recently has rallied, and we've been able to help a well be drilled in India. And so just the joy of giving as a group, a joy of giving together, it's tangible, it's like, might stretch our faith a little bit, But that is, I learned that that's a lot of fun. It's just the impact that you can make. I also learned the creativity of hospitality. Like, you don't have to have it perfect. And you can, you know, enjoy just cooking together and eating together. It doesn't have to be prepared for you before you arrive. That is like, this is life, you know. So I have learned to really, I really enjoy just kind of expanding and how hospitality can be done, other ways that things can be done. Also, the strength of sharing life together, like, you know, where someone has a need or someone else has, you know, a challenge at work, like, how do I be a Christian in the workplace? Or what happens in this situation? Or we're praying for our families and our kids, or, and just that whole, you're coming together. You know, you're coming together in prayer, you're coming together to reach out, you're coming together to rejoice. So there's so many things that can be caught versus taught. And it's not meant to be a small little church service. It's, you know, it's not meant for you to reduplicate what happens here on a Sunday morning in your home. Okay? Thankfully, Brian and I aren't leading worship at a small group. Mm. Right.
Yeah, thankfully. Amen.
So, yeah, those are some of the things. Brian, what are some of the things that you have
what?
Learned or received in a life group?
Well, I think of life group by different names as we've been involved. And I feel like there's always been, like, critical times in our lives of, like, stress or overwhelmed, or for us and then also for other people who have been in our life groups, that in those moments, like, I remember one life group we were in, the leader was Carl, and we were youth pastors at that time, and we were just totally overwhelmed with trying to figure out how to be married and have kids and be involved in ministry and do missions and everything else, and Carl, they prayed for us, and we were like, okay, yeah, amen, we receive it all, and then he goes, you know, and he gives me this simple tool, which I already knew how to do. Do you hate it when somebody tells you to do something? I do, kind of. I already know that, but you're not doing it. Okay, but I already know that. So this guy says, well, here's how what I do. You know, he's a business guy, owner of a business, and he said, every day I write down, you know, the 10 things I want to do, the first 5 most important things at the top. I'm like, I already know this. And then, so I kind of blew him off a little bit, not verbally, but in my head, you know, I kind of blew him off a little bit, and then afterwards, I'm like, yeah, I know that, but I'm not doing it. And, you know, it was pretty, it did impact me then. I'm like, yeah, there's no reason for me to be stressed about all these responsibilities because God does give me a practical way to get things done. So that was a real turning point for me anyway. Probably you didn't pick up on as much, but at that point. And that happened in a life group. One night in a life group and, you know, was just that little key that I thought I already knew, but I wasn't doing, so I guess that made me religious or a hypocrite or something, I don't know, but so I went back and started to do that, and even though I kind of hated the idea he was telling me to do what I already knew how to do, I started to apply that, and it really started to shift, and we started to be able in that next season to manage all the responsibilities that we had, and then different times, when we've been through difficult situations, there's times when a life group has just gathered around us and prayed. And we've been leading life groups where, you know, stuff happens. I almost said something else. Stuff happens, okay? And so there's stuff that happens in life, and it needs to be encouraged. It needs to be bound. It needs to be loosed. It needs to be, you know, we have to apply the scriptures to it. You know, that we've had the opportunity many times to do that over the years in these small communities, these life groups in homes and various other places. Back to you.
That's so good. It doesn't have to be perfect. And I've said already, like, you can come early, but if you come more than 10 minutes early, you'll just see what happens in the last 10 minutes. So it might not look that way, but, you know, I'll probably be cleaning, especially when the kids were little, or I would probably going to be cleaning the bathroom. You know, if you come at 10 of, because why clean it earlier in the day and then clean it twice? You know, so, but that's just real life, you know, so it's kind of like, come early but, you know, you'll just see what happens in the last 10 minutes. One of the things, too, I want to say that this would have been Carl Good, too. And I don't know if it was because he was leading our small group or because he would have been actually leading, at that point, Mannheim Dove. But Brian had traveled quite a bit. And he still travels right now with COVID. He's done the least amount of travel in the last year and a half of our whole married life. But one time Brian was away, and Carl had just called and said, hey, is there anything that we can pray for you about? And it was, the kids were pretty little, but I realized that when Brian would travel, I would not sleep as sound, which meant that till he got back, I was exhausted and probably not quite as happy as what maybe I could have been.
Amen, but sister.
So I just said, pray that I can sleep, you know, soundly when he's away. And kind of with that agreement, like, it, my prayer was, Lord, when I lie down, let my sleep be sweet. And my prayer was that I would hear what I need to hear, but if I didn't need to hear it, let me sleep. And, oh my goodness, that's been over 30-some years ago. So it's definitely been an answer to prayer. And that was an agreement where somebody joined with me in a very tangible, very practical thing that I needed so that I could be rested.
And it was your life group leader, not in the life group meeting itself, but it was your leader who called. And so it's not about that 90-minute meeting or 75-minute meeting or whatever. It's about the life that flows out of that gathering, out of that small community.
Anything else?
Back to me. We can go into...
Yeah.
I was just going to do this stuff.
Go ahead.
Okay. Dangerous now. We both have a microphone. So as Merle and Shree are learning, that there's a big commitment to elementary football or to junior high football. Like, when we're asking for commitment, like, to, you know, here's the honest truth. We feel like God wants to, we want to see a wave of new life groups start a week from now. We're going to launch. And I just want to say, this Tuesday night, we're having a leaders meeting, and it's catered. And Doug Lehman is from an Overflow Church out in Chambersburg, is going to be there. We're doing training. So you can still get in the launch a week from now. It's never too late. I told our golfers yesterday, it's never too late for a good putt, right? And on the 18th hole, bam, there it was. So it's not too late to get in. But we felt like God wants to launch new groups here in September. God wants to launch new groups in January, and God wants to launch new groups in March of April, okay? So we're serious that we're going to see groups started, and we want to call you to consider committing to lead a life group. And I'm just saying, you can get in, just let us know by Tuesday. In fact, I understand on the app, there's a place where you can respond and say, hey, I want in now, okay? And we'll get back to you about that. But commitment to lead a life group is much more like maybe once, twice a month there's a meeting, and then there's a leader meeting every 3 months. And so, like, there's a much higher commitment to elementary or junior high football than there is to lead a life group. I'm just saying, okay? Other things put demands on us that require much more commitment than what we're asking for right here today. So I just want to let that out there, lovingly say, we need more people to step up to the plate and lead life groups. And we also have amazing cluster leaders. Ask me, what is a cluster leader?
What's a cluster leader?
I'm so glad you asked. A cluster leader is like Brian and Alicia Nauman, Todd and Marie Good, ourselves, Matt and Hannah, and Merle and Cherie. And so cluster leaders help to support life group leaders. So if somebody in your life group is driving you crazy or something, you got a major breakthrough, you can report it. You can tell somebody that. So the cluster leaders help the life group leaders succeed. And so those folks are in place so that as we have more and more life groups, then there's more, and those people are already in place to give support and encouragement to the leader themselves and to pray for them and encourage them. So this is what we're building. We're building a wave of life groups here at Newport Church. And
something else that went along with just commitment and, you know, challenge you, that when you start or attend a life group, or, you know, if it's going to be September or if it's going to be like January, and I know what it's like to have, we had 5 children, and they were involved in all kinds of different things that from dance to soccer to volleyball, and we finished out on band. So, I mean, there was stuff in between there, too. There was even golf in there. Yeah.
Golf, yeah.
Yeah, that was probably one of my biggest learning curves.
Got the important stuff in. Yeah.
But anyway. But one of the things that I would challenge you is to give life groups the commitment for like a 3-month period of time to really embrace it and see if you like it. Mm-hmm. You know, see if you enjoy it. Make the time. You know, some of the life groups have a certain time they meet. Some, we were in a life group that we would plan our next time all together. So that's like commitment because we're all going around our calendars. You know, does this date suit? Does that date suit? And if you said it suited, you knew that it was kind of planned around you. So, hey, show up. But you kind of figure that you find time to do the things that are important to you. And I have realized that community around me is important, and I really value that. So
wrap this up.
Okay.
Because,
sounds good.
Okay, we're good. So what we're going to do is we've shared with you that you are anointed. You're a minister. And Janet was just sharing here. Is this my notes or yours? Okay. Janet was just sharing here about how, what has God given you that you, that's a lot of what a life group leader does. They just are passing on, or even just in that community. So what we're going to do, and you'll have like 30 seconds, so you can start thinking about it right now. We're going to get in groups, and we want you to share with the other people in your group something that God showed you that you could pass on to somebody else. So that could be in a life group. That could be something that someone shared with you in youth group, at young adults, at a life group at another church. It could be something you heard in a sermon. So this is crowd participation time. Sorry if you're a visitor. We're going to push you a little bit beyond your comfort zone, but you get to meet new people. And so in just a few seconds, we're going to gather in groups. And the idea is to pass on something that someone shared with you that helped you, that now you can pass on to the 2 or 3 or 4 other people in your group. And you have to keep it moving. You only have to do 5 minutes, all right? And then we're done. We're going to commission and bless. Yeah, go ahead.
So if you can't think of anything, you can also do the opposite and something that you have received from somebody, whether it's something that's been impactful to your life. Like Brian and I shared something that we've received in life group. So there could be something that you have received from a mentor, from a teacher. So in your group, it can be either or. You can share something you received or something you know that you kind of embody that you can pass on to somebody else.
You have 10 seconds to find a group. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Start sharing something that God gave you to pass on to others. Meet somebody new. You don't have to find out their name, even just say you in the blue shirt. What's that? All right, keep it moving. We got 3 minutes remaining. Okay, you have 2 minutes left. Keep going around a circle. One minute left, and then we're going to just focus your attention up here. Testing. Okay. All right. Just stay right where you are and focus your attention back up here to the front of the auditorium, please. You can finish after our closing prayer. All right. All right. So Janet has one thought, and then we're going to pray and close. You don't even have to sit down. It's all right. You can
just so it was just brought to our attention. This is for families, too. And your kids, I mean, that was one of the things that probably was helpful for us, because when our kids were little, they liked going to... At that point, we called it a cell group. So it kind of forces some creativity sometimes, but your kids will also enjoy the community. And so it's kind of stretches us, because it makes a little more work to get there. But families are also
a big part of it. Not every life group is going to have families, but many will have children involved, yeah. Sometimes our kids used to say, are we going to big church or little church when we're leaving in the house? They're all packed in their seats and everything. Are we going to big church, meaning this, or little church, which meant in our homes and to somebody else's house? So we're going to commission you to be the church, not just come to church. In Jesus' name, Father, we thank you, Lord, for this community, Lord, those who are with us in this room and those that are online, in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we just declare they are anointed, Lord, to bring the good news just like Jesus was. That's us. We are the anointed, Lord. And so, Lord, we bless that. And God, we just pray for these waves of new life groups to be released within Newport Church so that we can have community to reach our community in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so we're going to dismiss there. You can finish up with the group. I know I rushed you, Guy. What? Yes, and if you want to come Tuesday night for the meal and start right away, there's a button, and if you just, you can push, or if you want to start a life group in January, push that button on the app. If you want to start one, you know, seems a little scary, put it off till March. That's a good idea. You know, whatever. We're having waves of new life groups, so amen. We're dismissed. Everybody have a great day.
Thank you so much for watching this teaching. I hope that it impacted you in some way. If you enjoyed this teaching and would like more teachings like this, feel free to subscribe to our YouTube channel and get updated each time we post a new sermon.